e-gaming bets. We accept bets on computer games online since 2011. Referral system for regular users and the first deposit bonus. Gaming devices store and the best choice of payment systems. Dota 2 and Hearthstone, Counter-Strike and StarCraft, World of Tanks and League of Legends. EGB.com. You know for sure who's going to win.
G2A.com, the best video game store ever! Fast as lightning! Solid as a rock! Cheap as duck! What's more, you can sell on it because it's also a marketplace! Remember G2A.com, the best video game store ever!
Welcome, Counter-Strike fans from across the globe. I'm Jim Inesso, and this is the second season of Counterpit. Joining me this evening in the hot seat is none other than PDG and PK Noodle. How are we going, gents?
Wonderful. Really excited to be here. It's a fantastic day. We're inside in the air conditioning, casting Counter-Strike. North American, nonetheless, at midday here in Australia. I mean, pretty good day in my books.
Yeah, it's prime time for rhyme time here in Australia. We're just sitting here chilling midday, looking at some scrims and just ready to cast some great action. Of course, yesterday we saw Enemy engaged in a pretty good battle against the guys from Splice, and they were able to come away with a 2-0 start to their season in terms of their maps. So looking to press on today and get Cooster going with that AWP, hopefully get all those fanboys cheering nice and loud.
That's it. He really was plugging away. Almost at some points yesterday, just doing his thing, getting the frags. It really wasn't a noticeable or a standout effort, at least in the early stages, but somehow we looked at the end of the map and he had, you know, 23 plus 25 frags. It was just ridiculous.
Well, that's right. So I think that he started off quite slow. He had an unbelievable run yesterday. And I think from an enemy perspective coming into this match, of course, Enemy versus Winter Fox, I'd love the fact that they're playing back-to-back games. I think in a short condensed season, which this is, obviously with five teams, 10 BO2s in total to be played out over the course of about 2 weeks, trying to find, I guess, the ultimate champion and the team which will represent America over in Croatia in the LAN finals in March. I think that when you're feeling it and when you're in form, having back-to-back games is a great thing for your team.
Yeah, definitely. You always want to ride the wave once you're in there. So, you know, the surfing analogy where once you're in the barrel, you just keep riding until it spits you out the other end. And CS Forms definitely like that. If you're hot, you're hot. And the more games you play in a very short period, the better. We've seen even the top international players in the world like Device and Olof M. Sure, they have longer stretches of consistency, but even within their greatness themselves, they have periods where they completely dominate. So form affects every player. And right now, Cooster for enemies feeling it coming off a couple of good LAN tournaments. And it's going to be on the guys from Winter Fox, especially the French import XP3, who's the in-game leader and the AWPer. He's going to have a pretty tough time on his hands. Taking on essentially Cooster and the in-game leader mainline from Enemy at the one time.
You're right. I think the other thing that's going to be playing in Winter Fox's mind is the fact that we actually just saw this matchup, not only a week ago. Of course, we're talking about what was the grand final of the MLG American Minor Championship, in which Enemy won that BO3 2-0. They actually played on Overpass and Mirage, and what have you. Overpass will be the first map played tonight, so there's history between these two teams. It's all gone Enemy's way. And you can't help but feel that they're going to be out trying to continue those winning ways tonight.
That's exactly right. And I guess the onus really is on Winter Fox to make that change. I mean, essentially they're a team that we can look on as a team that's been given a lot of resources recently. They've certainly been enabled by some fantastic sponsors of theirs to further their game. And I do believe they've actually been one of the teams that have been given a gaming house. Correct me if I'm wrong there.
Yeah, no, training full-time in the Chicago headquarters of SteelSeries, I understand. So it's definitely a team in which You could have everything you possibly need as a team to succeed. But there comes a time, I guess, where the results need to justify the investment. And I think that's definitely the narrative that has been going the way of Winter Fox of late, where they haven't quite been putting out the results that should be or would perhaps be expected of a team to that has all this support. We've seen them, I mean, not qualifying for the MLG Columbus LAN qualifier. I mean, they lost out to Enemy, as we said, in the Minor Championship. They also lost out in the MLG Last Chance qualifier, ultimately going down to Games Academy in the Grand Final, the young secondary up-and-coming Brazilian team. So they're just not finding their feet. And a team that really, at one point, was recognized as a team that should be competing with the best and should be up there with the best in America. I recall them going over to an international comp or two when they had Pith and even Devil Walked in their lineup at that point. They've really fallen off the radar completely for me, and really they're sort of mid-pack at the moment.
Yeah, and it's one of those situations where you're looking at two rosters with, I guess, completely polar opposite builds in terms of how they've structured their team. We've got Enemy GG, who've essentially come from nowhere and built their roster organically. And what I mean by that is they started as a team, they've risen through the ranks. There have been roster changes, so their roster hasn't stayed the same. However, they've built that team themselves, and now if you look at their roster on paper, we've got Kooster, who's come out of the woodwork recently in terms of his fantastic form, but the rest of those guys really hadn't done anything meaningful. They didn't have any blowaway teams on their resumes where you could sit back and go, oh, okay, that's a logical explanation for why these guys are doing really well now. So they've got a really organic roster, and they're working really well together. On the flip side, you've got Winter Fox that has a French player, has a, you know, an in-game leader who's from the other side of the world. He's bringing that experience. You know, you've got Lex, who's a very experienced player. Flosik, Anger, Desi. These are all names that we've heard before in NA Counter-Strike. It's the Enemy GG guys are rising through the ranks, and I think that hunger is really driving them at the moment, and I like them for today's game.
That's it. They've certainly been the form team of late, and they've turned a lot of heads. I mean, yeah, a lot of the attention's been on Kooster, but I think it's the silent contributions of Mainline and Uber that have really taken this team to where they've gotten, essentially. I mean, it's certainly just not with the contribution of one player. Whilst he's been absolutely fantastic for them, certainly doesn't rest on his shoulders alone.
No, you're right. It's interesting when you bring up Mainline, because that was the player in which I actually wanted to talk about as well, because he is the in-game leader for Team Enemy. Previously, you would have seen him before Enemy playing on teams such as Method, another up-and-coming sort of American team. But his in-game leader style for me is always very interesting when you're talking about trying to accommodate a star player within to your roster. It just is very reminiscent to me of sort of trying to accommodate a Kenny S into a Titan sort of lineup, not comparing skill, but more so the disparity of skill between one player and the rest of the others. And it was interesting in an interview to hear Mainline suggest that he runs quite a structured team environment where everyone has defined roles and whatnot, as opposed to a looser style of play that an aggressive AWPer such as Kooster perhaps might like. So I think there's that balance there of trying to put him in positions to succeed, but at the same time making sure that everyone's on the same page and are working towards a common goal. And I think he's done a fantastic job of doing that and really keeping everyone on board. We saw yesterday some of those support players like Uber and like Relix really stepping up and stamping their authority on a match, and at a time in which Kooster was struggling, at least during parts of that match. So I really like the gel and the cohesion that I'm seeing from the team at the moment, and looking forward to more good things. Like you, Pete, I'm predicting a 2-0 Enemy tonight.
I think that's one of the definite perks of making a roster organically like Enemy GG has. By the time you get to the position they're in now, everyone is very comfortable in their role and it's clearly defined. You haven't had players coming from different situations expecting certain frag roles or certain aspects of their game to be incorporated immediately into the team. Whereas a Winter Fox GG, many of those players may have had predetermined expectations about the roles that they would play. And then when the team came together, the sacrifices that are being made by the players aren't maybe correct. Maybe they have some more juggling to do in terms of rotating people around to different bomb sites and trying people out in different roles. Whereas Enemy GG, they know what they're doing. It's just a matter of can they do it and what level can they do it at on each map.
For me too, I guess the rigid structure that is provided in the team also goes a little bit of a... Well, it actually goes a long way to also controlling player egos as well. I guess the problem with that looser style of play, and you've got one player certainly performing above and beyond, people's egos essentially need to be put into check, and I don't think that's certainly the case at all with Enemy. So I think Lenglong's done a fantastic job of not only structuring his team in terms of Counter-Strike, but also some beautiful man management as well. I think you only need to look at the player interviews, particularly with Kooster, certainly reflect that. So look, the maps for this evening, the vetoes have come in. The first map that we're actually seeing is enemy's pick. It's actually going to be Overpass as well. Interesting map for me, Nick, particularly given what they've got at their disposal enemy.
Yeah, really worrying, I think, here for Winter Fox. I mean, Overpass is certainly a map in which I really... I like to see Orpus play because it really suits the dynamic, aggressive style of Orpus, such as Kooster. There's so many different angles and setups that an Orpus can play on CT side. You can often see them going very, very aggressive, particularly at the A bomb site where they push towards the fountain or push up A long or even push down the stairs if they're bold enough. But by the same token, they can still play quite back in the sites and quite defensive. Imagine all the way back at perhaps bomb boxes in A or even watching B Monster Canal. And the difficulty there on the terrorist side is that it can be so hard to gauge where the AWPer is actually playing until you take that jewel. You can sometimes waste a lot of utility grenades trying to potentially flush out an AWPer or ensure safe passage as you progress up the match when there's no need because the AWPer's not there, and it can be a really scary prospect for me.
Yeah, we did see enemy GG at their best yesterday when they were playing at a very high pace as well. So very, very quick, very proactive, as I like to say. They took the initiative, they were the aggressors, and they were rewarded for it when they did it. So having that safety net in Kooster is really going to help them play that way, as I think we're going live in the knife round now. So all the players are going to slash and stab their way to victory. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 slashes, stabs, whatever you want to call it. I think Shanks. Overpass is... Shanks, I mean, look. Overpass is one of those maps where it's relatively even. Like, it is, it really depends on the team for me. If you're a CT-sided team, it's a CT-sided map. If you're a T-sided team, I think there's a lot of versatility and options for you there as well. So it'll just be, I think both teams, the fact that they left it in the map pool, it's obviously going to be enemy's stronger map. But Winter Fox should be prepared to play it. Otherwise, they should have just completely vetoed it as their veto pick.
See, I'm certainly a fan of Overpass as the customs because... Funnily enough, coming from an Australian background, we don't actually see too much of this map actually get played in competitive environments. But nonetheless, I do believe they're going live in a pistol round, so I'll let you take it away, Peter.
Beautiful stuff there, and we're going to go live in this pistol round. We can see that nobody's really keen to engage too quickly, but now XP3 and the boys will take their wares into short and try and get some control there, as it looks as though they're going to ignore Monster for just a bit, but they're going to use the short part of this B bomb site to put some pressure on. Having taken this and the door control, they're just going to slow it down a bit, making sure enemy GG didn't get too aggressive on them. But you can see Uber jump spotting over the wall there to try and get an idea of what's going on. And Koos has found himself in a wonderful position. Unfortunately, he's missed the first one, but does pick up a nice headshot there. But he's going to go down to Desi. So Koos there in a great position to get multiple kills and not really able to convert on it. But as we look at the T's, you can see XP3 still very deep. Not really certain as to where he want to take the bomb at the moment, but it looks as though he's going to make his way back to B, and it's going to be on Lucky to try and defend this one.
That's right. The CTs, I think they're definitely over-rotated to A. They're off the back of that information that Kooster had fed to them, that the Ts were swarming towards the A site. They're now forced to rotate back towards the B here. Desi, he'll lead in through the sandbags into short. The dust spot out mainline at the heaven there. So that first exchange has gone down, but really, not much damage being done yet, at least until Uber has his way. He does drop Desi now, so 4-3 man advantage to enemy. The bomb will go down here. CT's forced to retake the situation, but XP3, the French player here, really, he wants this to go their way. You can see he's keen for a good start to the night so far and get his team off on winning ways. We're in a 3-on-3. CT's just biding their time at the moment, but really, not much is coming of it, and they're just falling one at a time. Lex, Flowsick, they're all picking up frags, and all of a sudden, it's all to do for mainline, the in-game leader of the team, and he eventually goes down too. So, nice start there by Winter Fox. A little bit disjointed on the retake for me, though.
Yeah, definitely just trying to go in there one at a time and get that individual kill. It started off nicely there with Uber picking up that first headshot, but then ultimately it was, as you said, a disjointed approach back into the bomb site and an important pistol round for Winter Fox to win, Jim.
No doubt, and I'm sure Kooster will actually be kicking himself in that situation because, as you said, he was in prime position, ultimately flanked there in the end, but could have done some real damage to Winter Fox's round.
Yeah, and you can see that I guess this must be something going around in North America at the moment. We saw both teams do it yesterday. We have three rifles and two SMGs. So we're typically used to seeing a lot more SMG buys, maybe a Tech 9 and also maybe one rifle and a lot more SMGs. But the North American guys seem pretty keen that this is the best way for them to hold on to their anti-aircos at the moment, as the push will come in from short. The CTs will clean up a few kills and take control of the round. It's now 4-3, and Winterfox, after winning the pistol, are in a little bit of strife here. Lex and Desi both on low HP, and Mayon and Lucky have managed to get themselves two rifles as well.
That's right. You can see XP3, I think, off the back of losing those two members, he's quickly trying to regroup with his teammates and show some force of strength. But you can see this is all looking like CT advantage at the moment. Again, Kooster gets a frag. Mainline picks up another one. And why not have a double there as he picks off the last? And all of a sudden, enemy find themselves cruising to an eco victory there with four members still surviving.
Yeah, that's the real danger of actually having those rifles. If you lose them, they're going to cause you a world of pain. And now Winterfox is staring down the barrel of probably two eco rounds here.
Yeah, really costly round for them there. I'm just not sure why they didn't put the SMGs on point, because one would certainly lend themselves to thinking they're a little bit more expendable than the rifles. So, just not too sure what was going on there. But of course, now Winterfox on that back foot and just spreading themselves out across the map, as you can see on the overlay there. They're not really too keen on taking the engagements just earlier, as they bully Kooster out of the mid toilets there, and he needs to fall back because he's only on 17 HP, and if he's not careful, he could actually find himself losing his life here, as they do finally find him there in the toilets. He is finally traded out, and they will continue to try and get onto this site here. Only enemy Uber to try and defend it. He goes down quite quickly with a great headshot from XP3, but now the pressure's all on enemy as they need to try and retake this site. The bomb has gone down. Lucky manages to find Flowsick, but XP3 trades him out quite quickly, and another quick headshot from XP3. Great round from him with the triple kill.
Yeah, he's actually picked up a quad there, so beautiful entries. But I have to say, hand on heart, and with all of my years of Counter-Strike put into my brain, those are some of the worst anti-eco rounds back-to-back I've ever seen. Two teams with seemingly no, I guess, control of what they were doing. They've pushed with the guns. They've, you know, they've given options to the enemy that just shouldn't be there. So, disappointing start for both of these teams after they both really tried to wrestle control back early. And now it's Winterfox's turn to see if they can put these guns to good use. But Relic's taking down Anger with a grenade. And Anger actually dropping a grenade onto his teammate Desi, and Uber's now taken down Lex, so we could be looking at three of the worst back-to-back eco rounds I've ever seen, and it's going to be XP3 taking down one. What is going on?
No, Pete, you got that one wrong. I agreed with you on your assessment of the first two, but that is the greatest anti-eco loss with the TK grenade.
What is going on?
Anger was taken down with the nade in hand. Unfortunately for Desi's sake, it dropped at his feet and blew up Desi. This is Counter-Strike action at its finest. NACS, I believe the Twitch chat will be raining out with.
If anyone was ever to make a video describing NACS in the eyes of Europeans, all you need to do was watch this 3 minutes of CS, and you'd be pretty well versed in what they're talking about. But look, 2-2, and now it goes to enemy to see if they can defend the eco round.
The question is, can they defend the eco round? I haven't seen too much to suggest otherwise just yet. There's XP3 engages a little bit of a battle there in the mid connector, but this double monster control from enemy is going to need to be separated shortly, because Winterfox have just spread themselves across the map. That bomb is actually going to make its way back towards the playground and fountain area, so they're certainly backing off quite a bit there and trying to perhaps catch Kooster out like they did last round, or sorry, the round before in toilets.
Fortunately for Kooster, this round he's just got an SMG, and the rest of his team have rifles, so slightly more understandable. And both teams just really relaxing now after some serious heat coming through those last three rounds with, I guess, both teams would be extremely frustrated right now winning and losing like this. The only advantage they both have is they've made an equal amount of mistakes, and it's 2-2 on the scoreboard. So both teams still well within reach for this game to sort of go their way. But Kooster there, and Malin's in a great spot here looking over the sign on this boost, and he's going to see the first one. She should take him out. He does. Can he get the spray on the second guy? Uber will help him out and take one and two down. But XP3 is going to continue his good work entering the ACT spawn bomb site. And now, although they've got 23 points of health combined, should be an uphill battle here for Winterfox to pull this one out.
You can see Desi there. He's watching the bankers, and he, oh, I think he catches the shoulder of one. But Uber, great position in the end. they do shut out that round. You can see time was always against Winter Fox in that instance, with about 10 seconds left and really no position to make something happen. As we do see, I think...
It's the coach of Winter Fox.
The coach of Winter Fox. Okay, I was wondering what was happening there because someone joined the server and then suicided, which was interesting for me. But Enemy, finally, the first team in this match able to string two rounds together. And we actually saw this yesterday in the sense that Enemy actually start off a little bit slow, and especially on those first gun rounds, they were a little bit disjointed. But once they got their groove on, Pete, they were so tough to stop.
Yeah, and it's good to see Kooster still with that SMG. He's looking like he's middle of the pack at the moment, but he's yet to get that AWP as Uber sees one through the wall, and over the wall, I should say, and tries to spam him through the wall, just getting a bit of control. He sees multiple enemies here, so a large amount of information coming out here for the enemy GG team. They know that short and door area is going to be heavily polluted, but XP3 continuing his French domination, and will take down Uber through the wall. But once again, Kooster's managed to find himself behind enemy lines, and well, not behind enemy lines, because he is on the enemy team, so it would be
great hard pun to
get behind both lines. However, he's got behind the enemy Winter Fox, and he's picked up a couple, which should easily turn the round here in favor. And certainly does. Mainline picks up a nice triple on the eco, and 4-2 win. 4-2 to enemy GG.
That's it. Kooster again, just getting the information with that push. They're just sitting up at the picnic. Really, another situation where he was licking his lips. I know a lot of players love those anti-eco frags, and obviously still retaining an SMG. That money bonus is another factor as well. His money's quite healthy enough for him to actually afford an AWP this round, so expect fireworks.
Yeah, loving what loving the options the Koos will have on this map, being so AWP heavy, but he's going to do what he's done the previous round, is just push that party area, see if he can get a pick, spots one out, but the T, luckily enough, runs to the other side of the pillar. Kooster being nice and aggressive, and I like this start to this round for enemy, Nick. It's a good position here for Kooster.
Yeah, you can see, though, that whilst Kooster has been going for that early A pick, Winter Fox have reacted by moving up very quickly towards B. At least one member there. It is Flowsick. He's closely joined now by Lex. Had taken control of the short sandbags area, so they're actually putting some pressure on the B defenders there. So it's not all easy times for enemy at the moment. You can see now, though, they will back off. I think if you look purely at the HPs, you can see Winter Fox, they're hurting a little bit at the moment. Surely even more so now that Lex has gone down, really the heart and soul of the team. And Kooster, he adds to that pain as XP3, the in-game leader, also falls. So all of a sudden, there's so much to do for Winter Fox. You can see that they've got two members going towards A, but one's still lurking at B.
Yeah, for me, Kooster, once you find out where his AWP is, you should probably be going the other direction. And Flowsick tries to at least make enemy think that as he picks up a kill, but Uber quickly trades on, and now the T is going to find their way back to B, I think, is the right option. It's just whether or not they can get enough kills and get far enough in before Kooster makes his way probably to uppers and gets that nice AWP angle. But I like the pace here from enemy. They're controlling the game nicely.
That's it. It's just very, very slow and controlled as they try and find an entry here. They need to group up. Exactly what they're doing is Anger finds Uber there, but he's not going to check the toxic barrels. Taken down there by Relics, and now all to do for Desi. Unfortunately, he was quickly sought out by Kooster with that AWP. But for me, they were just a little bit disjointed that round, Winter Fox. They seemed to have players all over the map. I think they were trying to work a pick there, but in the end, not really having the players in place to trade where they needed to.
Yeah, I think the difficulty as well was the fact that when they were moving quickly towards B on the terrorist side, that there was some great utility grenades laid down. I know Lex took 50 HP damage from one HE grenade alone, so there was a lot of pressure being applied from the CTs, and they used those smokes effectively to lock them out of B side. As we can see, mainline, though, going very aggressive, and Skylar Pete following it up, so this eco around here from Winter Fox is getting absolutely annihilated at the moment. Having said that, they have picked up two frags, but all to do here for Flowsick in a 1-on-3.
Yeah, Flowsick needs to get one more kill here, and that'll be a pretty good eco, taking down three guns, which means it's going to slightly damage the economy of enemy. They look pretty good at the moment. Mainline on that 9-2 figure, Relics on 7-9. So they've certainly got control, not complete control yet, though, so if Flowsick can manage one more kill, it'll be fantastic.
I just want to point out, Jim, as well, you can see there, even though Flowsick is still alive and they haven't managed to find him out yet, you can see that Kooster's positioning, he had gone towards B that round. That's exactly what we're talking about pre-game, where overpass is the map that lets you rotate that AWP between sites, be aggressive, be defensive. It can be so hard to deal with.
Yeah, great versatility for the AWPer, definitely.
That's it. They can certainly play hide the AWP, as we like to call it sometimes, but it just keeps the other team guessing, and really... As you said, Pete, if they were going to try and avoid Kooster, having him rotate between sites certainly plays those mind games as well.
Yeah, Enemy GG actually, their caller mainline's doing a fantastic job at the moment. And Uber, we saw yesterday, putting up some huge numbers as well. So all the signs look good for Enemy. And actually, as we said yesterday, a lot of similar points coming out here. Kooster's on 7 kills, 3 assists. But he hasn't really had one of those rounds that makes us step back and say, wow, there he is. He's arrived in this game and he's taking control. So that's very worrying for Winterfox. He's got 7 kills and, you know, there haven't been any standout rounds. So if they allow him to keep getting these sort of meaningless, easy frags, he's going to end up doing exactly what he does there, getting ultra confident and strafing out there, taking down Floisic early and opening the round up for his team.
Well, how easy was that for him? In mainline, you spoke about him, the in-game leader, fragging up a storm. He's doing a fantastic job. I agree with everything you've said in that regard. He's leading the way with 14 frags at the moment, but off the back of that early pick from Kusa, you can see that Winterfox, again, they're in shambles at the moment. They're trying to scramble, but you're not going to win a match when you're coming down in a 3-on-5 situation every single round and trying to make something of it. I mean, the percentage plays, it's just not there. You can see they're slowly making their way towards A, but poor old Lex at the moment still in the stairwell in the mid-connector, so we're still looking at least, I think, about 30 seconds before they try and make something of this at the moment.
Yeah, unfortunately for them, Lucky 1G has found himself all the way up, pushed into this beginning of the B part of the monster part of spawn. So he's got a lot of information there, and he's just biding his time, as does Kooster sitting in short. So three players from Enemy able to just stack in that A bomb site. It's going to make life very difficult for Winterfox on the way in.
And as you can see, that early aggression from Enemy has really forced Winterfox to play such a slow game and really clear out every possible angle there, as Uber actually picks up 2 frags and the third. Nice and easy for him in that A site, but yeah, that early aggression, as I said, from Enemy is just slowing things down for Winterfox, and they're really having to take their time to clear out positions like such as Kooster was in earlier.
Yeah, and for me, I'm not really sure. There's a T that a terrorist player there from Winterfox who died to Uber, and when he died, I saw the smoke grenade drop off his body. That's really strange for me. There's about 30 seconds to go. You've got a smoke grenade, and you're hitting a bombsite, and yet you find no use for that grenade at all. So a little bit stranger. I think Winterfox are feeling the pinch a little bit coming in here, and definitely being put off their game at the moment by the aggression and the, I guess, the control that Enemy's displaying. But here's Winterfox. This is their attempt to get into Monster. So they're going to push up really fast, and these smokes and the flashes rain over. And Mainline's going to do a great job on the play, picking up one. Can he get the second? He won't get it just yet. And Desi and Floisic combine pretty well. But Floisic's got a huge opportunity here. Takes out Kooster, but Relic's on that quick orb kill reply. Now it's a 2v2, and it's all to do here for Winterfox.
That's right, you can see Relix here moving in. He does put out one anger, he has, but can't get the spray control onto him. Eventually takes him down, but oh, that first miss does cost him there as Lex does get the double kill and takes down Relix there to finish out the round. But oh, I think Relix will be ruining that missed opportunity he did have just there. Winterfox, I'm glad that they moved with a little bit more intent towards the B site that round. I think that it's probably the fastest and most aggressive that we've seen them so far this half. I think something that we've seen from them so far is that they do like to play that slow defensive style, but sometimes they can struggle when they can't have their way and they don't have that opportunity to set up flashes and smokes as they'd like, especially when you've got an aggressive team like Enemy coming right at you. So I like them mixing up the pace. As it is now, though, it's still going Enemy's way. Kooster and Mainline get a frag apiece. Lex does well to trade out one, but they're still in a man deficit.
Yeah, unfortunately there, Lex finding Kooster with a nice headshot through the wall. So Kooster going down without doing too much damage once again, but Mainline really putting the hurt on Winterfox with that underpush, getting a kill and getting Lex down to 12 HP. So as this 3v3 settles down, both teams are just really trying to do their best to find out what is open and what the options are, as Lex walks all the way towards the A bomb site on 12 HP, and he's going to look to make an entry.
See it, and this is the time where Enemy are just going to go and try and get some information, as we see Lucky there pushing through B, but Desi has great position up coming through the park in towards this A site, and they're just trying to look for a pick at the moment here. Lex only on 12 HP. Floisic is the man on the job, straight entering into that site. He does find Relix at the truck, but just opening things up. But now I need to try and get this bomb down here. Lucky is in a great position. He does take down Lex as well, so now forcing this 2v2 as Uber finds the second, and now it's all to do for Floisic on 12 HP. Unable to do too much there. Great retake from Uber and Lucky. Just great positioning there, great communication, and it's all coming up trumps for Enemy at the moment. Winterfox, as you said, just looking a little bit rattled.
They're not willing to commit to anything at the moment. I think that's their biggest problem. The round that they won, and this will be a common theme in a lot of our casts, because I heavily believe that the proactive team and the aggressor really gets rewarded in the round. You take the action of the opponent and make them, you know, decide what to do next. And the one round Winter Fox has got in the last few where, I mean, Enemy were able to string together six in a row. The one round the Winter Fox was able to win, it was a B rush. So they were the aggressors. They took the action. And speaking of taking the action, Lexola trying to spot one out here, but Mainline pushing all the way up. He's going hyper aggressive here. Picks up the first, picks up the second. We'll get a triple and he'll look for the quad. But Flow Six in the under areas, so it just ends up being a relatively standard round. I thought there was going to be something massive there from Mainline, but just a couple of anti-eco kills and a nice bit of control there from Enemy.
Yeah, I think he'd disagree. I think in his eyes, that was massive, Pete. That was a great play by Mainline. But I just want to say, though, we talked about Kooster as the star player, but what a menacing, scary threat Enemy are when their support players, such as Mainline, such as Uber, are firing. Mainline at the moment, 19 frags, 4 assists. He is leading the charge, and if they're firing, it makes it so much easier for Kooster. Takes so much responsibility off his shoulders, and the team are really thriving at the moment with that flexibility and freedom that they're being afforded.
Yeah, generally when your in-game leader is top fragging like this, you're almost an unbeatable prospect with any team. You know, for example, if we look at someone like Envious with Happy, if Happy is the top fragger, they're going to be in the position to win a lot of games. But at the moment, it's Mainline that's doing it. But Anger will cut his run short and take him down. And we see Relics here with an aggressive push into the smoke. So he might actually catch someone out. But Anger is ever ready to just look that way. He's hearing him reload. He sprays him down. The mistake coming in there from Relic should have bought his time, bought his time a little bit better as XP3 once again makes his way into A. And you can see Winter Fox once again being rewarded for their aggression and them taking onus on themselves to take a bomb site, not waiting for Enemy to make the first move.
That's it, and it's on Booster here as he does find that first frag. Uber actually finds a second as well, so they've already forced the 2v3. Can they do this 2v5 retake? They are red hot at the moment, but Uber does go down. XP3, the aggressor there, and Desi just finding Kooster before any chance of them retaking that site. 9-4 the score, and finally Winter Fox get that round, but they need more. They need to be able to string more rounds together because at the moment they're really just struggling with consistency.
Yeah, I mean, you can understand why Enemy went for that round. There's only two rounds left, and I think they can comfortably buy both rounds as they've got a full buy here, and they've got enough money to sustain and buy next round. So they were aware of their money situation. They wanted to gamble on the round, and they took that decision. So nothing against them, but unable to come away with that 2v5 as expected, as Desi and once again the Winter Fox boys take a nice and aggressive approach for this round. Desi picking up Mainline, so the danger man for this half for Enemy GG goes down, and now they will make their way into this A bomb site nice and quick. But Relics, they're doing a great job picking up one and a double. So nice manipulation there of the smoke. And you can see Kooster's on the lurk and gets the bomb down in the under section. So this is going to be an uphill battle for XP3 and Flosic as they try and regroup towards the bomb.
Well, it's been in nearly sort of situation for every single round, hasn't it? I can't remember the last time we said that they've been in a really advantageous position to start the round. Nice frag there from Lucky. Does drop Flosic, and all of a sudden, XP3 will have to channel his inner against all authority skills. Of course, that pro French team he played in back in Counter-Strike 1.6, but it's not to be as he does go down. But worrying times here for Team Winter Fox. I'd just like to cast their minds back to a week ago when these two teams played on this very map. Enemy was the victor there 16-7, but crucially for me, Enemy actually won the terrorist half 11-4. They're actually having a crazy CT half now, so Winter Fox, they're going to be scared.
Yeah, and we can see a force buy coming out here for Winter Fox, the last round of the half, so they're going to have to make do with this hybrid buy. We've got one AK on Desi and four pistols, including a Deagle and a Tech 9 thrown in with a couple of P250s. So we're going to try and make this A bomb site work for them. But Kooster is not going to have a bar of that as he pushes nice and aggressive, taking down Flosic. And he will continue to fight them and gets a second. So great work there by Kooster. Gets a third. He will pick up the headshot there at angle, which seemed to be a no scope or something quick. Auto director doing great favors for us and just dodging that action. It seemed to be irrelevant to the Valve viewer there. Thank you, Gaben, for that beautiful piece of coding you've managed to give us. We've missed the action once again, but now we see a 2v4 unfolding here, and XP3 will pick up the AWP and try and make it work here for Winter Fox.
It's a Kooster going absolutely nuts there, just defending toilets quite well, triple with the AWP, but nonetheless a lot to do for Desi and XP3. They're just having some indecision about where that bomb will actually go. They've split the A side here. Mainline is not having a bar of it and just simply disposing of them.
Yeah, the really scary part for me, once again, we waited, had to wait till the 14th round of action to call one round of Fooster going, sorry, Fooster, Cooster going insane. So Cooster has managed to go 14 rounds without doing anything particularly amazing, yet he's on 17 kills and 3 assists. So you can see what a powerful fragger he is. Whatever the round gives him, he's taking at the moment. So great start here as we move into the pistol round, and Enemy GG winning 11-4 in that half. So they're going to have a nice cruisy run home if they can win this pistol round, it would seem. But Desi seems pretty intent, and he does get the first one. Dropping the bomb, he gets the second. Can Desi go bigger here for his team? He can't. Relics trading, but XP3, the French player, the French Patriot, fighting mainline there. But once again, mainline will pick up XP3 and get a nice headshot there. It's a broken down into a 3v3, and now it looks as though Enemy want to get some attention drawn back towards that B bomb site while that bomb creeps long. So mainline, the in-game leader, still alive, very important. He's got the bomb as well, so it's going to pan out well for them, you should think.
Yeah, look at the mind games at play here. You can see Lucky just stalling towards the B site. Hasn't yet made his presence known, but you can only think that as on the overlay, Skylar regroups with mainline, that potentially they were just waiting to form a pack before he did commit that B fake. But as it is, mainline will just hit the frag onto Lex anyway, as Lex was going on a little bit of an information hunt, and that's really going to throw a spanner in the works for the initial strategy, but still leave them in a very strong position here. You can see again, Flossy trying to get information, does hit the bomb though. That's certainly a piece of handy info. He'll fall back, so all of a sudden, Enemy, this round breaking down, not going their way. They're in a 2-on-2. They need to recover that bomb. As my GoTV lags, I'm not sure if that's just me or you guys.
Yep, GoTV has crashed or paused. So not sure.
Mine's gone too.
What's going on here?
They're running on the spot. It's quite interesting. We'll try and get this sorted ASAP, which is not good for us. But in that sort of situation, I was just going to say, it looks as though Winter Fox were going to be up against it. You could see that Team Enemy were positioning themselves well for a nice little B fake. Lucky was over towards the B Monster Canal, and Mainline and Skylar were positioning themselves quite sneakily at long A. But that information play, as strange as it might sound, with Lex pushing through long A and dying, it still gave his team so much info because he spotted out the bomb. He knew that potentially an A attack was coming, and it allowed his team to reposition themselves. Flosik pushed off the back of that info and got one frag and the bomb. So by Lex dying, it almost worked out better for Winter Fox in that instance, as strange as that might sound.
Yeah, we see that a lot where information potentially is worth more than the kill itself. So by pushing and giving your team that information and allowing them to go through the decision-making process with extra information and which bomb site to hit and which how they can manipulate the different areas of the map, sometimes that information is worth more than your life. And certainly it appeared to be that way for Lex, but of course we're unable to tell you if the gamble was worth it at the moment, as the GoTV makes all the players look like they're running on the spot. So we're just waiting for the GoTV to...
As we're saying though, I mean, regardless of the pistol outcome, I mean, we only have to cast our minds back to a week ago when these two teams played each other and Enemy actually won that match. But like I said, they actually won 11 T rounds. So I think regardless of which way this pistol round itself goes, I think they're going to be extremely confident as they move into the first gun round. We already saw that ultra aggression from Enemy at the start of that pistol round as they really sprinted down through the mid-con area, up the stairs and headed towards the A bomb site, ultimately slowing down the pace though. But that's certainly something that we'd expect to see more of as we move into the main gun rounds. Certainly yesterday on Mirage and Train, they treated us to a fantastic show of fast-paced Counter-Strike, really bringing the game to Splice. And really, given the fact that they're up with a lot of rounds to play, certainly that they'll be running to run with that, Jim.
Yeah, I've just been informed by one of the admins that the game is actually updated mid-game, and the server has crashed as a result. So they are restoring the server via Ebot, I believe. But nonetheless, they've run a game update mid-match, and it's actually caused the server to crash. So just some interesting info coming through regarding that.
It looks as though the server's back up now, maybe?
Is that GG Volvo? Is that what we're suggesting?
Yeah, I think so. Okay. I think that's definitely the case in this instance
just
where
to clarify. Okay.
The game crashes if you've already got a game live where there's a Valve update, where it's probably one of those really awesome updates, whether they've thrown some sort of Halloween mask or Easter Bunny mask on the chickens in the map. It's going to be
gloves.
What a a new glove skin, some interesting cross-stitching coming out on the left glove of the terrorist model. Really, really.
I'd say there was a bit of a...
worth the development team, really worthwhile stuff there.
There was a bit of a manufacturing fault, I believe, in one of the gloves. The stitching around the thumb was actually coming loose. And as that stitching came loose, you weren't actually able to line up your grenades properly. So, of course, I think that's been fixed in this patch.
I'm glad they're rolling out now, then. That sounds as though that was situation critical.
Well, it's certainly the cross-stitching and the beautiful textures they use on the glove is certainly more important than 10 players getting the opportunity to fly to Croatia to play international Counter-Strike. So definitely in the scheme of things, you know, old Johnny No-Name running around in public service has to have his cross-stitching accurate on his gloves. So
On a serious note, I think one of the biggest benefits about the fact that they did release the glove update was the fact they actually made those gloves machine washable now. So it's much easier to cater for and look after as a player. Just chuck them in the washing machine, just 60-degree water, just gentle cycle.
Yeah, definitely. And, I mean, we've heard a lot about player unions being formed where pro players are forming unions to protect themselves against orgs and against Valve. Well, certainly the player models also have their own union that they've created. The player model union where the in-game characters have fought for their own rights, such as holiday pay and... you know, all the different things that you get in those packages. So the player model's really being looked after and had cold hands. So, yeah, it's basically just a great initiative by Valve setting up that player model union.
No, I agree wholeheartedly. I mean, it's something we could spend a lot of time talking about, but probably a lot of people right now are confused as to what, in fact, we are talking about. Just to reiterate, the server has crashed, guys.
So whoa. And by the way, we're not British. We're Aussie. We're Australians.
I've been called out for being British before. Apparently too British. Not Aussie enough.
We're not British. That's all I can say.
But no, we are just waiting for the server to be restored thanks to Gaben. An update was actually rolled out mid-match, which has caused the GoTV, but of course the server, more importantly, to crash as well. So the admins, that fantastic admin team, are on the case at the moment, guys. So we should be underway very, very shortly. They assure us that they are working on it. But the next map after this, guys, if we're to cast our eyes forward, I'm not sure we mentioned what it was before. It will be Inferno, which was Winter Fox's choice. I mean, we probably have a bit of an opportunity now to cast our eyes forward whilst we got this break. Thoughts on Inferno, Pete?
Inferno for me is, I guess, one of those maps where Kusta could absolutely decimate Winter Fox on CT side because he has that hyper-aggressive, close-range AWP style that can be very effective. We've seen him push all the way up here and get really close and take those tight gun battles with the AWP. Certainly, Inferno is all sort of close-quarter battling most of the time, apart from the midsection and maybe sections of Banana. But even then, with the use of smokes and Molotovs, it's usually a pretty close to mid-range battles going on. So for me, Koos is going to play a huge part in their run on Inferno, which... he will in every map. But with mainline going the way he's going, anything can happen. It could be him going the hypercarrier today.
Well, that's right. I mean, you have to give him so much credit, don't you? Look at the scoreboard at the moment. He's got 23 frags, but the frags he's having, he's making it look so easy. I know that a few of them were eco frags in which you're a little bit overexcited, but for the most part, he's actually just been doing a fantastic job of going quite aggressive and really supporting Kusta in his role very effectively. And I think with those two playing on top of their game at the moment, it's really setting up enemy really, really strongly.
That's it. Interesting for me, Pete brought up a great point, is that normally a lot of AWPers can get shut out on maps like Inferno, but just because of the close quarters natures of the map. But for me, Kusta really just uses that AWP sometimes like a shotgun, as we saw, I think, just before that GoTV went down. He was able to get three quick frags in succession in the toilets there and really just picked apart that Winter Fox push into the site. So, yeah, I think Inferno is going to be Kusta's map, but don't really underestimate the contributions of Mainline and Uber.
Pete, from your experience, of course, used to play for professional CSGO teams here in Australia, most recently Team Chiefs, who are currently representing Australia at the IM Taipei Regional Minor, which starts tomorrow. What about your experience of playing with young up-and-coming players? I'm just thinking in the terms of Kusta now. He's getting a massive rap on his shoulders. He's getting a lot of attention, getting a lot of publicity that perhaps previously he wouldn't have been exposed to or experienced handling. Well, you've had young players in your team who have had similar sort of raps on them. How do you manage and help them succeed despite all that mounting pressure on their shoulders?
I think there's a lot more pressure on younger players when they get handpicked into already top-tier rosters. I think that the way that Enemy have formed their roster organically through a process of trying players out and making sure everyone's in their comfort zone. And Kooster's definitely referred to his team as friends of his that he's played with for a long time. So certainly that's more of an environment where someone like Kooster can perform during these, I guess, booming phases of his career where he's getting a lot of attention really quick. His friends in that team can help keep him grounded and make sure that he understands what each round is about and each game is about teamwork, because they're in that friendly environment. I think that if he was to join a team, let's say like Liquid straight away, let's say Liquid hadn't got Simple in some sort of opposite world and they'd found this Kooster guy and picked him up and he'd been thrust into the spotlight with already well-known professionals, I think that relies then heavily on the leadership qualities of the team and what sort of leaders are like in the organization as a coach and also in the roster. How are they going to look after a player like Kooster? But in this instance, I think he's in the perfect situation now where he should probably get at least 6 to 12 more months under his belt in an environment like this and then really make a run at going to one of the top tier teams if he doesn't fizzle out and he's able to continue his growth as a player.
That's right. Certainly from our own experiences in the Australian scene, which is of course our native scene, we've certainly seen, unfortunately, one too many young players who really haven't had that support network around them and have been thrust into the limelight too quickly only for it to go horribly wrong for them. And really, they never ever reached the potential that a lot of people expected of them. So it's certainly a difficult task managing that, as is the case with managing young talent in any way of life, in business or in hobby. But certainly I agree with you in everything you said, that at the moment he's got a good group of friends around him and a good group of players which he's comfortable playing with. I think that'll certainly aid that transition and make it easier for him. And really, I mean, there's a massive, massive future upcoming for this guy. I mean, he's a great prospect, really down-to-earth guy. If you listen to any of the interviews in which he appears in and have a chat to him, really down-to-earth guy, and so excited for what is coming up for him in the future.
And just to keep everyone filled in the Twitch chat, if you've just tuned in, the score was 11-4, I believe, was 11-4? Yeah, 11-4 to Enemy GG, and the game serve has actually crashed halfway through the pistol. It got on the second half. It got into a 2v2, and then a Valve update has caused all 10 players in the server to crash as the server's updated mid-game. So I believe it's going to be restored at the pistol round of the second half. I don't think there was an outcome in that pistol round. We're not sure because we disconnected, but the action should resume with an 11-4 scoreline at the start of the pistol round. So to Enemy GG, and they'll be moving into their T side on Overpass, second map being Inferno in this best of two for Canopus Season 2.
No, you're spot on there. That's certainly the status quo as we understand it. The admins are working very, very hard at the moment to get the match up and running. But in the context of this season, it's worth reminding people that with only 5 teams, initially it was a 16 round robin group for American Counterpit, but with some teams dying, as is the way of not just American Counter-Strike, but also Australian Counter-Strike, teams dying and opting not to play and whatnot, the season has now been restructured. So we had the opening night yesterday with 5 teams. Of course, the other teams being SKDT, Splice, Enemy Method, and Winterfox. So 5 teams, all competing for that first place prize, which will be a spot at the LAN finals in Split in Croatia in March of this year. $80,000 on the line. We've already had teams such as Virtus Pro, Navi, Envious, and Team Immunity secure their spots, be it invite or direct qualify, at the main event. And for these 5 teams that we've just listed, this would be a massive opportunity, wouldn't it? I mean, apart from perhaps Winterfox, I'm not sure, from my experience as an Australian caster, if these sort of players would have had that opportunity to compete on the world stage before. I know Winterfox have, but I don't think the other 4 teams would have. So this is an opportunity that potentially that a lot of these players would have dreamed of for a long time, would have set their sights on, certainly would be working towards as part of their greater goals for Counter-Strike. And Jim, it would just mean so much, no doubt, to these guys to have that opportunity to represent their country.
Oh, exactly right. And they're joined by an elite company. With the teams that, as you said, have already been invited. Have you gone through the teams at all that have been directly invited to Canopit?
Yes.
Excellent.
Yes.
So,
Jim, he's just trying to get the server restored. So it's not as though he just completely zoned out. He's just speaking with the admins at the moment. But in any case, we are working as fast as we can. But thank you, Gaben, for rolling out an update mid-competitive match. I'm sure all the players, spectators, admins appreciate it all. But in any case, we can see at the moment. Enemy, they are leading 11-4. Just to recap on recent results, I mean, we saw these two teams play at the MLG American Minor Championship. They actually met each other in the grand final, in which case Enemy were able to come out the victors. They won 16-7 on... No, they won on Overpass and Mirage. I do apologise. I was looking at the wrong line there. But they came through ahead on that instance, and certainly they're looking the goods at the moment. You can see that Prod, Winter Fox really got bullied around the map, got pushed around. Mainline and Trista were really having the way about things and set themselves up well.
Yeah, it really was early aggression from Enemy that, I guess, in a map like Overpass, forces Winter Fox to really slow things down on their Terra side, particularly if they haven't been aggressive themselves, and they weren't. They played a really passive T side, which late round forced them to have to clear all these angles that positions Enemy were in earlier. So I think Kooster was in really forward positions solo by himself in quite a few rounds there. Winter Fox were really wary of that and had to take things really slowly in order to get into that A site. So yeah, just those mind games being played quite well by Enemy across the map. And as we saw, it resulted in an 11-4 scoreline at the half.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you're spot on with that point. We'd just like to, again, just reiterate to everyone, we really appreciate you guys sticking with us. We're sorry for this extended break. Of course, you probably recognise that we're not American. We're not actually British as well, for the record. We're actually Australian. You can follow us if you would like to stay in touch with the Australian scene or the rest of the American counterpit scene, because we actually will be bringing the rest of the games to you. Broadcast from here at midday in Australia, which we love. You can follow myself on Twitter at PKNoodle. You can follow my co-caster, who's actually gone for an emergency toilet break, which I'm a bit concerned about because he's still not back, at IMPTG, or our familiar name and gracious producer of this stream. You can follow him on Twitter at DeepGimpact as well. But the question, as my co-caster gets back from the emergency toilet break that I spoke of, Pete, I will throw to you, because it's something that we're not quite familiar with here in the Australian scene, in terms of teams such as Winter Fox in this instance, having that sponsorship and having that support network around them. Really, in the context of the Australian scene, the only similarity or parallel that you can draw is Renegades, who clearly were picked up by the American org. They're now spending a lot of their time in American boot camp in Las Vegas, playing competitions abroad against these sort of American teams. From your experience as a player, I mean, I'm just trying to justify or work out why they would be struggling for results when they got this support. What are your thoughts there in that regard?
Well, if they're not getting results and they've got the resources, then they don't have what it takes, basically. They've had enough time now to get their stuff together and get some results on the board. By the way, I just want to make a quick point. I wasn't on a toilet. My graphics card got delivered. So my new graphics card arrived, which means I was jumping off. Yeah, so that's why I had to dash. But I think that you've just sort of proven the point. There really isn't a similar process here in Australia. We don't actually have a single organization that provides anything remotely close. The only one team that has this opportunity is the Renegades, and they're in America. So I think that sort of situation where that level of support is involved, I think is completely removed from Australian gaming. We surely hope to get there one day. We surely hope to get there and build the scene to a level where sponsors want to come in and devote that level of, like, you know, salary and accommodation and all the trims and perks of being a professional gamer. That environment doesn't exist here. So from a personal perspective, I can't really tell you what it feels like to have that sort of resource behind you and either not win or not perform like you should. But certainly... I like a famous quote. It's one of those coaching quotes that comes up on your Facebook and stuff all the time. It's, you know, those who can't achieve with resources, you know, wouldn't achieve without them. It's basically is what the quote is. So if you can't succeed without the resources, you wouldn't succeed with the resources. That's not going to define your level of success. It may aid you slightly, but if the drive isn't there, if the talent isn't there, if the work ethic isn't there, you're not going to gel and really make that jump to be a top tier team. And in the same regard, if it is there and it is all there, you can make it. E.g. Renegades from Australia. They had the drive, they had the talent, they had the dedication, and the opportunity came to them. So I think that, you know, you in this situation, you create your own luck, and it's time for the Winter Fox guys to appreciate their position they're in and really string some results together.
Just let's not forget as well, because you raised great points there, but it's not as though they've just had this sort of position of great support for a short time now. I mean, previously they were in obviously organizations such as Luminosity beforehand, I think Mythic for a short duration in between. And Luminosity, of course, are now famous for picking up the Brazilian team that are, I think if you go by the current rankings, they're top four, top five in the world, depending on which source you look at. So they're a big organization themselves as well there, obviously with a few tweaks to the player lineup. But certainly they've been a great position to succeed for quite a long time now in the American scene, but still trying to find their feet to probably their own disappointment more so than anyone else's. But I hope for those guys that comes together for them very, very shortly, because I'd love to see particular players such as XB3, one of my idols in Counter-Strike 1.6 when I was growing up. Certainly used to play in teams such as Against All Authority, Dimension 4, Mushkin, Atlantean, those sorts of teams. So I'd love to see him back on winning ways. Interesting about XB3 though. Short little side story before I throw it back to you. Actually, I mean, to give you some context about the skills that he possesses, when he moved over to America, actually took a little bit of a hiatus from playing Counter-Strike for a short amount of time. For whatever reason, we're not too sure, but during that period or break in which he did not play Counter-Strike, he actually took up a different game, started playing a game called Shoot Mania. Never heard of it myself, no idea what's involved, but took up Shoot Mania and actually practice enough to join what was the best team in America at that point in time. So he's clearly got a lot of drive for success, clearly a very talented individual no matter what he does. But he decided to come back to Counter-Strike, which we're all certainly appreciative of here in our scene.
Yeah, and just to clear up in Twitch chat, if you're joining us now for the first time, we are just waiting on the server to update. So the game isn't actually going live. The admins are working overtime and doing their best job to get the server back up and running and get everyone connected. But as it stands right now, the server still is playing a bit of games with the admins. But you can see that Enemy are up 12-4 currently. They won the first half 11-4 and managed to secure the pistol before the server crashed. So when the game will resume, and I think we're pretty close.
I think
close
we've just been given the GoTV details. So I'll pass them on to you in private message. The server does look as though it has been restored, guys. So I'll forward them both on, which you should now have, and we will rejoin the server for you guys. And the players are just starting to rejoin, so fear not, you haven't missed any action. Just to recap, it was 11-4 at the first half. We did see Winterfox starting out on the terrorist side and really struggling, only picking up those four rounds, but more importantly, they didn't look very decisive or confident in their ways at all. They were bullied around the map. Mainline and Twister in particular were just really getting frags seemingly at will. So it'll be a massive ask for Winterfox to mount a comeback. We've seen in the recent head-to-head that Enemy have had Winterfox's number. So I think when this second half gets restored, I assume we will be starting out from zero all. I don't think the pistol round had been completed at the time in which the server dropped. And Winterfox going to have to string together 12... out of 15 rounds.
Yeah, and they're just discussing I'm not sure the exact circumstance of what happened, because the GoTV was a minute behind. So in that minute, clearly there's action that's unfolded past when our coverage stopped that has to be sorted out. I think by the looks of things, they probably should just start from the half and replay the pistol. But obviously, with so much on the line, that trip to Croatia, that international experience on the line, everyone wants to make sure that the games are played as fairly and as accurately as they can be.
Well, that's right, because it's interesting. I mean, if we look at Winterfox as an example, because let's not forget, the season actually had started only to be paused later on and reset now with this new structure with five teams, the BO2s and whatnot. It actually started about 4 or 5 weeks ago. In which case we actually saw, I think, Winterfox play 2 or 3 matches. They were off to a strong start, won a couple of those games. For those guys, they've got to be a little bit disappointed, because they were closer to taking that step towards that first place and that trip to Croatia. But now they're back at square one, and they really find themselves on the back foot here now. So it's going to be a lot of hard work for these guys to really get their heads back in the game and get back on winning ways.
So, you know, I guess it's just going to be a question of who recovers better from this little intermission than the other. I mean, Enemy certainly had the upper hand. We know that their T side is awesome, and they've backed that up a little bit, but I do believe we're actually going to go live back into the game. The scores have been reset. It is a complete restart of the second half, so 11-4 will be the scoreline. Forget what you heard, that 12-4 has been erased, and I believe they're starting scratch in this pistol.
Yeah, they're just going to have to get the knife round out of the way, because the bot will automatically restart the game from scratch. So the game will resume at 11-4 to Enemy. GG, starting on their... they'll be on the T side regardless of the outcome of the knife. This is, of course, the second half, not the first half. They're just getting this out of the way to make sure the match is played with the bot, the score bot, in the correct order. So we should be live here in the second half of the second game of the second season of Counterpit.
I was wondering how many twos you could throw in there. That's about all you got, though.
I was going for the Jay-Z 22 twos reference, but I only got to three, so for him to get to 22 was a mad problem.
19 left, beat you close,
I'm not even going to get close to 22 twos. we should see the pistol round going live here soon. And, I mean, enemy came away with the pistol. Then I believe Winter Fox ecoed them, similarly to what happened in the first half. Definitely this gives enemy another shot at closing out this game, because the pistol round's so important that really enemy GG should look to secure that, and then it gives them a second chance at winning that anti-eco again.
Yeah, look, normally I talk about the fact that with these sorts of technical breaks and pauses and whatnot, that sometimes it can favour one team more than the other. In this case, I don't think either team would benefit. I think that probably both teams were just as keen to get the match over and done with, or at least play on. They were certainly had all warmed up, the rain was on, at least for some players more than others. But they would have just been as keen. The fact that they now had to wait 10 or 15 minutes to resume this second half, they're probably just keen as beans to get it live and underway.
See, it was certainly keen as beans to bring you the second half, but Volvo had other plans nonetheless. So I guess we just have to grin and bear it. And that's unfortunately how the cookie crumbled this evening. So, look, I think it's important that Winter Fox get themselves involved in this match as early as possible. I think it was some great work there in the original pistol from Winter Fox that put them in that position. But look, they just need to get started. They need to overcome this time deficit, because I certainly think enemy's confidence was growing as that map went on. I think we've just experienced potentially another GoTV lag. No?
No, we're good.
Good to go. Sorry, tense moments there. It happened to us once before and wasn't keen for it to happen once again.
Yeah, we don't need our Trodecaster going on another emergency toilet break.
It wasn't an emergency toilet break, mate.
Oh, that's right. It's the graphics card. That's right.
It was a graphics card.
Yeah, that's right. Sorry, I didn't read your Steam friend's message. You're right.
Bloody oath, truth, mate. The graphics card.
What sort of graphics card did you get, Pete?
I have a graphics card that supports my new 6-monitor setup. So.
6 monitors to me. Now, please explain to the 8,000 viewers why you need 6 monitors. That's not going to improve your CS ability. You realize that, right?
I didn't have any CS ability to start with.
I'm glad you recognize that.
I just got lucky. But this 6 monitors should allow me to chill in my my crib and watch The Hobbit on super high def. I guess that's really the only thing I got going. It's that Samsung. I can't remember what the name of the actual screen is, but it's the Samsung one with those 6 monitors mounted. And there's only one graphics card that powers these monitors, so I needed to order that. And now that that's arrived, I can pursue my dream of watching The Hobbit in super high panoramic definition.
That or playing the latest Microsoft Flight Simulator.
I was going to say, don't lie, Peter. You're really just going to be watching The Castle in crystal clear high definition. Dundees.
The great part about having 6 monitors, gents, is that I'd actually have to choose what I want to watch. I could put 6 different things on. I actually could do that, so whatever.
That's good, mate. That's good. I'm going to find you
cross-eyed. Although, I would be keen to try out that CS with that graphics setting where it extends your peripheral vision. So I remember doing it in CS Source on 2 monitors where you could look into an area and it would expand your game to the full resolution. It was fantastic. But look, I think we're going live here now. The pistol round between Winter Fox and I think surely everyone has heard enough about my monitor situation.
Forget
for this game to have gone live and
forget the monitors, Pete.
Forget the monitors. Cast the action as enemy GG will try and win this pistol for the second time as they group up. And it looks as though they're going to be going into a fast B hit. So all for one, one for all here at the long tunnel. Anger will pick up the first. Anger will get the second. Anger will get the third. A trip headshot there for Anger. But mainline will answer relatively quickly. And Kusta gets on as well. So 2 versus 2 day here after great work from Anger. This is a very winnable round here coming up for enemy GG as Kusta spots one out. He needs to connect on this kill for the round to go their way. You feel Desi able to do enough there. But mainline, who actually was the star player in the first half, going over 20 kills. I think he finished on 23 before the scores reset at the half. So doing a lot of heavy lifting here for enemy. And with XP3 in a 1 versus 1, They got a minute to go on the bomb, so anything can happen.
Yeah, I'm probably glad that we find ourselves now in a close situation, because that's certainly how the first iteration of this second half pistol went before the server crashed. But we now see Mainline plenty of time to work here. You can see he's done the bluff here, where he's fallen back from B, only to make his way through the midcon area back towards short. But as he drops down into water there, I was wondering whether XP3 might have heard it. Doesn't look as though he is, but XP3 has to be on his guard here. You can see him backing off towards the A site, just trying to position himself close towards the A bomb site. But as it is, Mainline will step out from short. They both know where each other are now. And as the bomb goes down, it's all up to XP3 to try and get in there. But oh, it's not to be. Mainline fakes it out. And nice headshot there. Gets three frags and continues in the way that he finished off with that first half. We said he had 23 frags, while he's continuing with that hot form.
That is exactly right. And that brings the score to 12-4 now. For those viewers that have just joined us, it is not nil all. Unfortunately, that Valve update caused the server's scoring system to reset. So 12-4 the score, they will resume.
And once again, we see this three rifle, two SMG by this American. The American teams are loving at the moment. And this one's worked out pretty well for them as Cooster opens up onto the Winter Fox Danger Man XP3. Of course, the French import playing for the American team. And just a really defensive approach taken here by enemy as they slow it right down and let Winter Fox, you know, push into them and make some silly decisions. But it looks as though Winter Fox are going to be pretty content with just getting a pick or two here and there. But Desi able to open up onto Uber, getting two hits down there and then securing the frag onto Lucky. So good crosshair placement there from Desi as he picks up one. And once again, these anti-eco rounds are just insane. Like, there's no consistency and there's no structure to them. It's just players wandering around the map trying to find other players. It's a pretty scary prospect for both teams.
Yeah, it just seems as though enemy going away from their natural style here. We spoke at length about how aggressive they are and how they like to get in the faces, but Desi, as he picks up a nice another 1B there, ripping the head off Uber, will get his second for the round, and enemy getting picked apart. All by one man at the moment, but it's a team effort. His teammates will be channeling to him, as you can see them, Pete, moving up towards the A site here. And Desi, as the server lags. Oh, no, good. Fortunately, the server's still going. A little bit dropped. But Cooster does take him down, Pete, and it's looking very, very ominous here for Team Enemy.
Yeah, but Cooster's still up, so this is going to be problems for Winter Fox, because they have armor. So Lex able to put down some spam there, but only connect with Mainline. But Angus picked up a Deagle headshot. So all of a sudden, the star player for enemy GG, Cooster, is left in a 2v1. If you did want anyone alive, it would be this player for enemy GG. There's only 6 seconds left, though. He's not left himself enough time to plant the bomb. Should have committed to the first plant and has been punished for it. Brilliant patience there by Winter Fox. And once again, we see an anti-eco being lost by a team in the server.
It's a disturbing trend, isn't it? I mean, these teams are really just struggling to cope with that second round anti-eco, as we like to call it. But a lot of these teams are actually force buying, so I guess the term anti-eco is really just a little bit dated. It's almost like an anti-force buy.
Yeah, but you're spot on there, actually. It's definitely a situation where most teams are going to push these buy situations and push the envelope in terms of their economy, being rewarded for the guns like the Tech-9, which we can see enemy has purchased a full set of armor, Tech-9s, and grenades. But Desi's going to line them up and get one, two. Here goes the third for Desi. So a big round him for him already. And he probably could have got the fourth there, but XP3 chimes in with that one just to make sure... You know, Desi didn't have too good of a time. Mainline taking down Plosic, but this should be a pretty easy closeout round here for the Winter Fox players.
That it is. Anger there with a nice headshot onto Mainline, despite whiffing that HE grenade a little bit, bouncing off the wall instead of throwing it towards the sandbags. But Winter Fox 2-1, I think the enemy off the back of forcing that last round, trying to get their revenge instantly onto Winter Fox. They now find themselves on an eco round. Probably not a bad thing for enemy. I think it's best for them to just try and, I think, calm down a little bit, boost the money across the board, and really just come out with guns blazing on that first gun round. They only need a member. 5 is the magic number that they're looking for. For Winter Fox, it is 12. Ignore the scores at the top. We have already played one half here. And Desi, again, opens the exchange, Pete.
Yeah, Desi's putting in the work really hard here for Winter Fox, picking up not only lots of frags in the last couple of rounds, but that anti-eco that they won, he was the main factor in that one, as Cooster picks up a headshot of his own and picks up an M4, so this can still be a decent eco round here for enemy. If Cooster's able to get either the plant, one or one more kill, or both, or a combination of anything more than one kill, of course he won't. He'll just run with his knife out, which I can't really understand. after picking up an M4. But he thought he was going to make his way all the way into B with no resistance. It didn't pan out, but what is going to pan out for him this round is the AWP in his hands, and he's going to try and put that one to good work.
What is it? Nonetheless, a new gun round coming out here in the first real chance for both teams to duel it out head-to-head. But I think we spoke at length earlier about that magic number. If you can get three frags, as we see a little bit of a, you know, a love tap there coming in from Uber. But if you can get three frags on that eco round, it's a successful eco. Because essentially you can force the economies there. But just this early aggression here from Desi, trying to get some information, almost trying to mirror what Kusta was doing in that first half. I wouldn't be too surprised to see a really passive strat here from enemy. Just really take their time, close things out. Try and hit a site, yeah.
Yeah, it's not surprising that they're taking this approach because they've been on the back of a couple of bad losses in terms of their ecos. But once again, you need to be able to identify what's successful for your team. And certainly for enemy, that's been the being aggressive and taking the control in the round. So whilst it makes sense for them to like go down this progression and get more defensive on their T side, it's actually would be most beneficial to them to get back into the face of the Winterfox and put some hurt onto the bomb sites there as Lucky sprays down Desi through the smoke, being ever aware while Mainline gets tagged pretty low. So basically still a 4v4, Mainline clinging to life there on 9 HP. And I like the fact that Koos is still up and he's surveying the map at the moment, seeing what the best option is. And unfortunately, XP3 will miss that shot, and Kooster and Lucky will combine there to trade onto the A player. And now the smokes and flashes will come in, and Lucky will try his luck pushing into that bank area straight down the stairs. He will pick one up as well as Relics on the other side of the bomb site, and Lucky will come back up the stairs, take out Flosik, who managed to get a double. And an impressive round there for enemy after they really got the pace going.
Yeah, comprehensive display. Whilst Flosik did pick up two quick frags at the end to make it look a little bit more respectable, that round was really well and truly in the bag for enemy the whole way along as they really picked up those frags as they progressed up towards the A site. A point that I'd make though, something I really did like, is whilst they didn't start out the round aggressive, once they got that first frag and then that second frag, they moved very quickly up onto the A side and capitalised. Recently in the Australian scene, we criticised a lot of teams for struggling to have that real intent and presence once they get those early opening frags, but certainly enemy showing that they're fast to capitalize and move on to those bomb sites.
Yeah, we can clearly see that enemy are interested in the B bomb site this round, dedicating a lot of their members to that short and monster area on the map. But as it stands, Lex is just going to put some hurt through that little wall, trying to pick up some spray, and he will connect with Uber just a little bit. So interesting start to the round here for enemy as Anger patrols that monster area and takes down the Danger Man mainline, but he'll get traded nice and quickly. Uber proving menacing there, taking out Anger in short. And now after some Molotovs and smokes, it looks as though the A bomb site will be the target of choice, as you can see one of the CTs making their way back to A. And this should be interesting here for the defenders, but one of those players is XP3 and he's able to connect with Lucky and slow the pace of the T's down. Ooh, a nice angle there. But Kooster finds an even better one, and he picks up a second as well. So Kooster awakens a little bit and picks up a double, but he'll need to do a lot more in order to win the round. Flosik, unfortunately, unable to connect on the bomb planter there. And now it's all left up to Lex, and he's going to do his best to try and save. But an excellent round there coming out from Kooster just when his team needed it.
That was absolutely world-class what Kooster did just there. But Flosik really needed to do better with that flank. He had the bomber cold and unfortunately wasn't able to prevent that plant nor get a frag at all, completely flanking all of enemy. But exactly right on that read, Nick. Once enemy make their decision on where they're going, they hit that site rather quickly and don't allow any breathing room at all for Winterfox.
The point that I'd make is in that situation, it was actually a 3-on-4 for enemy, but the speed at which they're attacking the site, it all of a sudden becomes a 3-on-1 or a 3-on-2 because the defenders don't have time to position themselves because of that speed. So they're seemingly still finding these man advantage situations in which they can exploit. So fantastic work from enemy. They move closer to that magic number of 5 in which they need in this second half to win the match.
So those of you watching at home who aren't 100% sure, it is currently enemy up 14-7. 11-4 first half. We're in the second half of action here. It's 3-3. And enemy look to have finally gained some control of this match. Their money looks good, and they've got the other team on eco, Winterfox here. But as we've seen so often in this match already, the team who's on the eco looks to be coming out on top here. Though in this particular enemy have managed to trade out, and now they'll, well, they should make their way pretty quickly into B, which is empty, but they're just going to take their time and set up for a more aggressive approach here for Winter Fox. But Desi's in such a fantastic position. He might actually take out Relics there, but he's been spotted. But in saying he's been spotted, Lex takes down Kooster and the Danger Man goes down once again.
Was it just me, though, who did see Desi there winning another duel? Jim, we're seeing them move their slowest on these anti-eco rounds. It's as though they play a completely different style in them as to what we expect from them normally.
Funny you should say that, because that's exactly the sort of read that I think everybody was making on this, but it's really costing them because, funnily enough, the CTs are the ones actually making the moves and catching a lot of individual players out from enemy. They were caught all in individual positions there across the map. Really no sort of structure amongst them. So that's exactly where they were getting caught with their pants down, per se. And subsequently, we see another team, or another anti-eco loss.
Yeah, and I mean, at this point, I can safely say, after, I think that's the fifth eco of this game. It could be the fourth, but probably the fifth. I think that it's just pretty silly the way they're playing it. I'd go as so far as to call it a dumb play style, where you can run over a bombsite full of CTs with guns that are fully armored up to the hilt with every grenade known to mankind. But for some reason, when they have pistols and no resources, you don't think that you can get into their bombsite. It's a pretty crazy approach to take, considering how well the rounds unfold for you. And once again, without that aggression early, with that slow, methodical sort of take, enemy's been shut out, and they really need to get back what's working for them, which is being aggressive.
The difficulty I see as well, because enemy, I think, are still obviously extremely well-placed to win this match. They only need two more rounds, but the longer this draws on, I think the more hope and confidence it gives Winter Fox, and momentum even, as we move into the second map, which will be Inferno. Of course, that's also Winter Fox's choice, and I think that even if enemy to come out victorious on this map, if Winter Fox can make a game of it, I think in mentally they'll be coming out almost ahead.
Yeah, definitely. And it's one of those situations where maybe enemy don't actually realize what's working for them. Is it the map? Is it the bomb sites? Or is it the speed in which they're playing, as Lex gets rewarded for his aggression? Takes out one, but Relics is there to trade onto XP3. But brilliant round there by Lex, sorting them out in his section of the map in toilets. But Winter Fox doing a good job here, 6-3 in the second half, of course. So this moves them right along to 10 rounds. So the score being 14-10 at the moment. And some real urgency needs to be shown here by enemy, Jim, to try and close out this match.
Yeah. Should I say, yeah, that fourth factor that you didn't perhaps mention was also the lengthy pause that we had as a result.
I can't actually hear Jimmy. He's talking. I hope that everyone else at home can hear him. Pete, can you hear him?
Yeah, I can't hear him.
Okay. Yeah, my Skype, I've changed.
Well, I've got no idea whether people at home can hear him. But in any case, Pete, perhaps you just take it away whilst Jim confirms.
Yes, there's just some microphone issues there. But at the moment, enemy really intent on taking the middle of this map. And lucky 1G's in a great position there in stairs. However, once again, this pace for enemy isn't that prolific. They're just sorting it out. But it'll end up pretty well for Uber, that entry fragging genius, picking up Lex early on in the round for enemy and taking that one out. And Kooster also picks one up. So this is going to be a easy bomb site for the T's to take. But Anger doing his best defense there, taking out Kooster and slowing the T's down as Floyster gets right behind Lucky and gets the bomb. So what was an interesting 3-4 situation has now deteriorated for enemy, but once again, Relic's able to take control, and Anger's going to be in a pretty tough spot fighting a few different angles here, and he's just going to, I think he just should go down, but he doesn't. He manages to swindle his way through that smoke and take down Uber. So now it's a 2-1, and the emphasis is on Anger.
Yeah, it does a good job there, but at least I guess enemy have the advantage that they have rotated back towards B, so they'll get the bomb down. But oh, Relic's playing, throwing, I guess, Russian roulette in the sense that just stood out in the open. Lucky to survive that as he did retreat, reposition himself now at short in close quarters with mainline. So I like the fact that they have regrouped here. Anger, you can see he does go down to check the monster canal, knowing that Relic's was last there, and really wasting a little bit of time here. Precious few seconds, you see the Molotov come out on the bomb that will force Anger's hand. He will push, gets the first frag, of course, not knowing where the second one is, doesn't have a kit, so he taps it. Perhaps expecting it could be a monster. You can see he repositions his crosshair now on short. Again, time running low. Whilst he should get the frag, and does, I don't think there's enough time. Great job from mainline there. And in the end, I think Anger, he needed to be a little bit more cognizant of the fact that he didn't have a kit, a little bit too slow to move. Wasted a precious few seconds there initially as well, checking monster canal. Great job by enemy. They're now on match point.
I'm going to go ahead and give enemy GG players the credit there, because I think when Anger killed the first terrorist in short, the terrorist may have communicated he didn't have a kit. So by seeing that angle, maybe he saw he didn't have a kit, and then the beautiful no peek there from the last T player meant that he knew he had to sit for full 10 seconds, didn't peek the 5-second defuse, and was rewarded accordingly there with the round. But now, enemy stream flashes and smokes into Monster, and it's going to be Anger with an opportunity to go absolutely ham. He picks up one, but doesn't continue to spray through the smoke. Oh my goodness, Anger! 1, 2, 3, 4, Flossy picks up one in between. Anger rattles him down. So much damage from those barrels. It looked as though he could get a 5-bullet team down at one point, all the terrorists lining up, but... great shutdown there from Winter Fox, and enemy get obliterated on that monster push.
That's the beauty of X-Ray. We have the advantage of seeing exactly what could potentially unfold before our very eyes. But of course, once again, Anger just unlucky in that situation not to perhaps pull the trigger and get what he deserved. But that's the first time we've really seen a fast strat from enemy, and it really didn't pan out for them at all. But nonetheless, they're trying the same thing on the B site, this time without the utility or the guns, and geez. That was over in about 2 seconds flat.
Yeah, I must admit, whilst they lost that last gun round, just preceding that obvious ET round just there, I've got no problem with it. I like the fact that they moved quickly. In the end, they got slaughtered. A lot of great counter flashes came out from the CTs at B there, which stopped them in their tracks. Anger had an absolute field day, but I like the strat. Like to perhaps proceed and go back to A, where they've had some more success in terms of bomb sites, but I want to see that fast pace come out. I don't fault them at all for the way in which they, approached that previous gun round, Pete.
Yeah, and they've decided to go for the eco here as well. So they've just slightly force-bought, leaving a little bit of money for themselves to make sure they get those AKs next round. And they'll probably look to do something a little bit more defensive. And maybe that two-paced approach we've seen where they start out nice and defensive. And then once they actually get those picks, they react to them very quickly. So hopefully we see enemy move towards that style of play in the next round. But for the moment, they're just content with their Tech 9s and their P250s, and just waiting for Winter Fox to push into their crosshairs, but Winter Fox not obliging at this point, just staying nice and defensive. A lot of action been coming the B bomb site way, Monster and Short being two tightly contested choke points in the last few rounds.
Yeah, you don't give a lot of credit to Anger here, as he's prepared to defend B-side again, but he's got 21 frags in what has been 12 rounds so far, and adds to the tally, gets another one, can't quite get the second there. Gets taken down, but quickly Flosik is there to help him out, and this force by not going the way of enemy here, Jim.
Not at all, but they are going to get the bomb down, or at least attempt to. This mainline, unfortunately, is just sitting there caught in the site. Now, once that bomb has gone down, Lex has to wait for his teammate, though, XP3. They do try and recoup here. They do find mainline in that site. Great little spray from Lex, picking up relics as well. And they just cling on in this match. They extend things a little bit further. For those of you that have only just joined us, it is not a new half or a new map. It is simply just the result of that server crashing. So, enemy just sitting on 15. And now Winter Fox on 13.
Yeah, and I guess, strangely enough for Winter Fox, Anger has been the aggressor in this half for them. He's got 150 damage per round, so more than a kill per round coming out, more than 1.5 kills per round coming out for Anger. So he's doing his level best to try and pull his team back into this match. A fantastic second half performance so far, but that needs to continue as the rest of his team, I guess, struggle to really put those rounds together. And enemy GG will take that cautious approach to this round, just feeling it out and making sure that Winter Fox don't get the jump on them anywhere in particular, as we see Relix fighting that monster tunnel, keeping Anger engaged at that point as we have a look at the map. And the bomb's still down at T-spawn, so definitely enemy not committing to anything too early, and the CTs are pretty content with just holding passively and allowing the action to come their way as Booster and Mainline are finding their way up long, so it looks as though it's going to be an A squeeze here.
Yeah, subtle change though in the setup of the CTs. They actually have three members that you can see, Lex, Desi, and that final member in the form of XP3 all guarding this side at the moment, so they're well positioned, Pete, as this attack moves up.
Yeah, it's going to be definitely an A hit, and unfortunately there's three CTs still at A, but that doesn't mean they can't make this work with the fragging power that they have. So the smokes and flashes rain into the bomb site, and it's going to be XP3 in that close quarters orbing duel. Can he get one? Oh, he not only gets one, he gets a second one there. He tagged Mainline through Kooster, then finishes off Lex with the spray down, and Uber picking up Lex. Desi onto Uber straight away, and now it's going to be all left up to Relix to try and make something happen, and Desi picking up that AWP. Can he find the kill? It won't matter. Anger will come from B, and brilliant defense there by Winter Fox. And one more round, and we're going to over. This is make or break now for enemy, and they don't have the best economy to accommodate a match point needed for them.
No, that's exactly right. They're going to be on a force buy here. Great work from Winter Fox, though. They're really starting to rally a little bit slow into this match, but on their CT side, they're starting to put it together. Enemy just suffering a little bit, perhaps. I know you rated that B rush there, but still, that's possibly what's come back to haunt them. As we see Desi pick up a nice AWP frag there. Nearly the double, but able to be traded out there by Kusta. So now, more importantly, Kusta has an AWP, courtesy of that frag, but they are just executing fast into this A site.
Yeah, definitely, and not only did Desi get a kill, but he's done so much damage to two other players as the trades come in. XB3 and Lex locking down those two kills, and it's going to be on Lucky in a 3-versus-1 here to try and save the match for his team. The bomb is down, and he's in a pretty untenable situation, but to make this work, he's going to have to find all three kills, and he finds Flosik. Great start to the round there. Pops that cheeky little smoke around the corner. Tries to manipulate it. He will, and he's got a pretty good idea of where both the opponents are now. So he's trying to fool Lex into thinking that he's gone to bank, but he's given himself away with the spray through the wall. And this is tense stuff here for Lucky. Make or break for him trying to win his cut for his team. He'll peek around the corner. Lex will do the deed. We're going to overtime. Winter Fox versus enemy. And what's set out to be a one-sided affair for enemy has proven to be a very close-knit competition. Winter Fox putting in a fantastic performance off the back of 23 kills in 15 rounds for Anger.
Well, that's right. In the words of Greg Popovich, of course, the San Antonio Spurs coach, show me some nasty. And Anger has certainly done that with 23 frags in one half. Absolutely exploded and brought some life back. But 11-4 to Winter Fox in this second half. I think enemy must be ruining those missed opportunities with the amount of anti-eco rounds that we spoke of that they seemingly threw away. This should have been a comfortable victory, of course, being up 11-4 at the end of the first half. And even in that first half, I think they lost one or two anti-eco rounds. So the fact that they now find themselves in overtime, I think they've got to be kicking themselves. Perhaps some signs of the young, inexperienced nature of the team coming through there and that inability to close out that match, at least in regular time. I think Winter Fox, I mean, seemingly from their point of view, Jim, they've just come back into this match and they've got some life again.
That's exactly right. They've become reinvigorated after perhaps what, just to fill everybody else in, we had a lengthy pause because a game update was rolled out essentially in the first pistol round of that second half. But look, they've rallied, they've come back, they've overcome what we thought was an untenable deficit given how strong enemy's T-side on Overpass was. And here we are in overtime. Great work from Winter Fox, starting to rally, starting to perhaps even, I wouldn't go just as far as saying it yet, but justify all the hype around them and the support that they've been given as a team.
It'll be interesting to see exactly how many frags Anger ended up on, because I'm not sure what his stats in the first half of that match was before the reset, but he was on 23 kills in 15 rounds. So that says to me in the first half he's at least managed seven or eight kills minimum. So he's on a 30 bomb, which is a fantastic performance from him. It's not necessarily something that we expected to happen. There's other players in that team that we think should go, I guess, a bit better than him. Desi and XP3 come to mind. Those two guys often are the instigators, but great work there by Anger.
I was going to say, Mainline, funnily enough, we saw him fall off in the second half. He was on a similar scoreline, actually, 23 frags in the first half of the match and only ended on 5 there. So whilst it was a good effort across the course of the map, certainly wasn't able to carry his first half form into the second.
I think the difference is, though, in terms of the roles that those players fill. I mean, Mainline is the in-game leader. I don't think he's expected to be able to drop those sort of massive frags and those bombs that we saw in that first half routinely. I mean, it's wonderful his team when he does. You can see how well they thrive when he's actually producing that quality frags. But it's up to the other members, the Relic, the Uber, the Lucky. I mean, obviously, we talked about Kusta a lot, but I think there's other members, such as those three mentioned players. They need to step up their games as well. You can't just rely on the in-game leader. Whereas Anger, I mean, he's been brought into that team as a rifler. Got a lot of talent, a lot of pedigree, played with a lot of top teams beforehand. So it's good to see him producing and filling that void his team needed.
Yeah, brilliant stuff there from Anger, really putting the wood on enemy GG when it was most needed. Winter Fox going into that half needing 11 rounds, which is a pretty big ask on Overpass. It's a can be an even map, and especially with the options available to Kusta on this map with the AWP, I certainly think that they did a great job containing him. But in saying that, I'm going to put more of the onus on enemy and actually, you know, mainline in this instance. I think when you have a star player and a star AWPer like Kusta, who's able to win rounds at will, I don't think he A, had enough AWPs in that, so the money management was pretty poor in that half for enemy. But also, when he did have an AWP, they were very defensive. I thought that they could have used, he could have used his star player a little bit better, injecting him aggressively like they'd been doing on CT side. Sometimes the best approach to take in these rounds is actually the winning approach and just doing what's working for you as opposed to what side of the map you're on and how much conventional Counter-Strike you should play and the safe options and all that sort of stuff. It's when you have someone like Akusa who's so dynamic, sometimes it's just best to put him into a position and let him, his individual talent shine through, because I think he's by far the best AWP player in the server, so he should be allowed to abuse that fact.
That's exactly right. And just to clarify too, we are going into overtime on this map. It is a $10,000 starting money. And of course, MR3 is the score set. So we'll spend 3 rounds on each side and try and battle it out until we have a victor. So an interesting first map in this best of 2, gents.
Yeah, it'll be interesting as well, because we understand that I think Pro Winter Fox have another game. Oh no, it's, I believe Enemy have another game, an RGN match after this, which... depending on how long these two matches for Counterpick go, could be starting to conflict with each other. So I think the players and the team coaches slash managers at the moment are trying to just best work out how to accommodate both competitions. Of course, we want to make sure, from our point of view as a spectator of this event, that we'd love the opportunity to watch both matches. Certainly, if it's anything to go by in terms of the quality, we're seeing this match in overtime, certainly the next one would be the same. But
and just to clear this up for everyone, this game has been delayed slightly due to a few server issues, but this game is currently in overtime. It is 15-15. Both teams secured 11 CT rounds, so 11-4 to enemy in the first half, followed up by an 11-4 half by Winter Fox on their CT side. We're currently just waiting for the $10,000 best of 3 each half to start. And once that's locked in, we'll be able to conclude this map or possibly go to a second overtime. We've seen that the T-side struggled to get rounds, so maybe it's the case of whoever gets 2 T-side rounds on their bit of overtime will easily secure the match. But we're just waiting for that overtime to start now.
Also, to just chime in, because the server update, or should I say the game update, was actually rolled out midway through that match. As a result, Ebot is unable to be used for this second half, so they're actually having to pop in all the console commands and all the overtime configs manually, so that's what is taking a little bit longer. We're also waiting for, as you said, enemy to sort out their schedule for that RGN match as well, so that's what's taking a little bit longer than expected in this first half of overtime.
It should be good though. I'm just thinking, sorry for the pause there, I was just thinking in terms of, in the context of this overtime, from an enemy perspective, obviously they've just come off the back of a 11-4 scoreline, not in their favour on the second half there on the T-side. Now, with the overtime rules, we will see enemies starting out on T-side again, continuing, obviously swapping how the match had initially started. But from their perspective, with 3 rounds, I mean, surely the goal is going to be to achieve at least 2 and get 2 T-rounds on the board from my perspective. I'd like you said, Pete, I'd like to see them, they're going to have the flexibility of getting the AWP and Kusa's hands on at least 2 of those 3 rounds, given the $10,000 starting money. So I think that's a big plus in their books. Certainly they struggled with their economy in regular time of the match, but I'd like to see them take it towards the A bomb site and be a little bit more decisive moving up towards the site. We saw they had a great ability and a great finesse in terms of capitalizing and pouncing on sites once they got a frag or two, but they did struggle in the early game in terms of getting that early positioning and moving up with a little bit of energy towards the site. So I'd like to see them do that and concentrate on that, and I think that they'd be well set. From a Winter Fox perspective, Pete, what do you think their goals would be?
Well, the Winter Fox perspective, you just need to hold on to what's been working for you and hope that enemy don't figure out some adjustments they can make to beat your defense, because we saw nothing from enemy that showed any capacity to really break down the Winter Fox defense. They won a few rounds, but it was more or less just situations where Winterfox gave away picks early. Once the Winterfox players had settled back into the bomb sites and were playing defensive, I don't really think that enemy had too much to get into those bomb sites in terms of set strategy, smokes, grenades, flashes to really shift up and manipulate the way Winterfox are holding. But the key for me here is to recognize that who's been dominating and why for Winterfox. Anger's been at that monster position, just creaming people coming out of that monster tunnel. And for me, just having Koos to AWP that, waiting for the smokes to fade, waiting for the flash to fade, knowing that Anger's hungry for those kills because he's been so successful, he might actually give himself away to Koos to just AWPing that line, as it looks as though we're going live in overtime now, so we can see all the action unfolding here in front of us moving into this round, as it looks as though the terrorists are just moving into a pretty default holding pattern and not really too stressed about pushing up at the moment. They're just content on making sure that the Winterfox players don't get any unnecessary advantage by pushing. So just a really nice even start. As we look at the minimap, you can see almost a symmetry of dots moving around the map. We've got five players on each side just sort of shadowing each other's movements. And Koosta has taken this AWP to long.
See, Koosta just allowed that freedom to do whatever he pleases at the moment. And he's just trying to work a pick there into the monster tunnel, but it's just a really cautious start from both teams to this half. We haven't seen any sort of CT aggression at all, and likewise, the T's are really just taking their time clearing the angles.
Yeah, this doesn't bode well for me. Enemy GG haven't really shown the capacity to really get into bomb sites with any set execution, so it's a mystery to me why they've allowed this round to go on for so long. Literally 45 seconds to go and no damage being taken by a single player on the whole map. So super cautious approach from these two teams, as they realize now, I think, after all the resets and pauses and time that's elapsed, how important this match will be to both these teams moving forward. As Uber opens it up nicely, picks up Anger. So the star player in the second half going down, but Flosik is pretty quick to reply. And now with only 22 seconds left to go, it's going to be all on the enemy guys to get into this bomb site. And once again, they're going to struggle, but Mainline picks up a nice kill there on Lex, and they continue to work their way in. Flosik picking up a double, and Desi getting into great position. He picks up one, he'll spam the second through the wall. And once again, the late push from enemy being completely denied by Winterfox in a fantastic display of holding patterns and discipline there.
Yeah, they just left themselves no time, did they? Because even in that instance, had Lex gone down, obviously, or Desi, I should say, had he gone down, obviously, he got two frags, but there was still only about 5 seconds left for that T to get that bomb down. There's no time to play with. You need to at least give yourself some opportunity. They did do what you suggested, Pete. They did send Koosta towards that monster canal, looking for that early aggression from Anger, but great use of smokes and utility blocked off his vision there. You can see, though, this round, they have got 5 AKs across the board in the hands of the enemy players. So Koosta's going to have to make it work with the rifle in hand instead of the sniper. Has taken a little bit of damage as well, but like to see them mix up the pace. Desi going aggressive at long here, catches Koosta. So the danger man is down. These support players now need to make something of it.
And a good kill there from Desi. Once again, reward for aggression, as we love to say here. Taking that initiative, pushing up long and finding Koosta completely unsuspecting. And Anger once again should be on here for a couple of kills. He gets the first one. He sprays down the second one. So nice piece of control there from Anger at long. He picks up a third. So his hot streak continues in this map. And he should get a fourth. Can he find it? He does. Brilliant play there from Anger, completely shutting down that monster section. And once again, the enemy GG players coming up empty-handed from that B attempt and left reeling as Winterfox go up 2-0 in overtime here.
Yeah, Anger just continuing that punishing form that he's in the late stages of this game. As we said, he amassed 23 frags in the second half and has just continued that form now into this overtime. I'd be interested to see how he deals with it in this third round.
Yeah, definitely man to watch there, Anger, as he picks up that AK. And now, of course, enemy GG are going to have to make this partial buy work. You can see only 3 smoke grenades and a Tech 9. But Koosta with that Tech 9 makes it work. And he almost actually picks up a second kill. So this is where we've seen the enemy players take a fast in the past. But this is going to be a blast from the past instead of a fast in the past. And as I trip over those words, I'll pass that along to Nick before I get myself.
I'll try and recover the situation somewhat here, and certainly that's the intent of enemies. They try and recover this last round in the half because they need some sort of buffer zone as they move into their CT side here. You can see that this is the final round of the first half of overtime, if you follow me. Winter Fox at the moment, 2-0, and XP3 hits a great spot onto Kruser and takes him down. He did have 4 points of health, but could have still done a lot of damage, but you can see them now pushing onto the B site. Flowsick in a fancy little position there. Actually had surfed up to the top of the wall, but gets one, but that's all he's going to do with not much cover to go by there. Interesting position. You can see Winter Fox now forced to rotate towards the B site. Mainline, though, not having a single... not dropping a single beta sweat there as he does take down Lex, and great Molotov placement will block off XP3 and make it a whole lot harder peak for them to retake.
Yeah, 3-1 here for XP3, so good result here for enemy, losing those first two rounds in pretty spectacular fashion, being completely held out by the clock and then by anger, and Desi's dead, but XP3 will also go down, and that AWP will go down, and 2-1, a pretty standard half given what we saw in regulation, 2-11 for halves, so it will be the battle of who can secure the three CT rounds by the looks of things. And with Kooster AWPing that CT, I'd have to say that I think enemy GG may be able to pull away here and finally get those three rounds, Jim.
Yeah, they've given themselves a great chance by securing that T round. Whilst it was the last round in that set, nonetheless, I feel as though they've got the momentum to try and close this out. But early aggression here from Winter Fox is just pushing enemy back into that site, and whilst Mainline has some info here, the entire team has gone A-long.
Yeah, and it's going to be really aggressive here. All five members have made their way here, and Kooster's going to be on like Donkey Kong here if he can manage to get the right angle, but the smokes and flashes are good, and so are the Molotovs. Relix actually dances around that bomb box and picks up a triple, so brilliant defense there coming out from the enemy GG role player. And beautiful defense there. I thought Kooster was going to be on for all time, but unfortunately he got flashed out and no one coming the short way.
It's always a fantastic feeling, isn't it, when you lay down a Molotov grenade, look away for a few seconds as Relix did, only to later find that that Molotov did enough to take down the oncoming terrorist team, at least one of them anyway, but did a lot of damage to some of the other members. Great 4K there by Relix, really stamping his authority. It scares them away from the A-bomb site. You can see them now, all five members going towards the B-site, so fantastic job there. Stamping his authority on this second half of the first overtime.
Oh, and that was a heavy-hitting grenade there from Uber in combination with his Molotov has taken down Anger, the Danger Man. So as the enemy GG players stream into the short section and the monster section, it'll be Mainline coming through that door and making sure that this round is closed off. But Winter Fox do a great job. Desi and Lex trading effectively there, getting Lucky and Uber to go down. And now Desi will pick up one over the top of the sandbags before Relix makes his way in. Now it's a 1-1, and this is a very tense situation. Lex having no idea. He almost flicks Kooster. Almost choked that, but manages to get the kill. Runs back to find his AWP. And it's Jim, it's going to be 2-0 here with enemy GG trying to close out the match.
Yeah, two very fast, aggressive rounds from Winter Fox being shut down. That one was probably a little bit more of a trade fest than anything else, but nonetheless, just being closed out quite quickly.
But we didn't see that from Winter Fox, did we, in the regular time on their T side, of course, before the server crashed. Nearly the entire half, they were so slow, they were so methodical. Didn't work out so well for them, obviously only getting four rounds, but completely different tempo being brought to this overtime. Not working for them at the moment.
That being said, we saw enemy go down 2-0 before securing their first T-side round, so all hope is not lost for Winter Fox here, but Kooster's in that position, and he sees Lex and gets that shot to land, and now he'll give his team a one-man advantage as the smokes and flashes come in, but I think you'll find Winter Fox have abandoned their B pursuits, and they'll let Kooster just regroup there and find himself in B. But now they're going to make their way back towards the A bomb site. But fortunately enough for enemy GG, they've managed to make the correct rotations. Now it's a matter of just waiting and hitting the shots, Jim.
That's exactly right. And they're just going to regroup and slowly make their way through mid. So just really taking the time, again, to just check all those angles, aware that potentially enemy players have pushed as they did in their first set of CT rounds. But looks to be a nice slow A execute here as enemy just prepare themselves for the onslaught.
Yeah, and Mainline there throwing a flash for himself at long, and he won't find one there, but Desi will go down as XP3 trades and the map's changed. So I can only assume that enemy have managed to very much defend that bomb site, and unfortunately the players have not waited for the round to end before they have changed. So we can only assume that the outcome has been to enemy's way. GG. enemy win in overtime, and a great finish to the game, I guess.
Yeah, well, I can only imagine we didn't see it, but yeah, sincerely apologise to all the spectators out there. Just like you, we had our arms in the air as that map changed halfway through the final round there. Of course, the players at the end of each match, they do need to wait out 420 seconds before changing it for the very reason that otherwise the GoTV will get cut off, as we've just seen firsthand. But I mean, we can only assume, I think it's safe to assume enemy won that final round, obviously won 19-17 on Overpass, which was their choice. I just want to say, though, it was looking quite sketchy, even as that round was unfolding. Obviously, we didn't see how it finished, but it was quite strange in that Winter Fox had three members moving up towards A. We did see Mainline Pete taking that battle. But the bomb, I'm not sure if you noticed, was actually in Flo6's hands all the way back at T-Spawn. So regardless of how that exchange actually went in A, it looked as though it was going in enemy's favour. The bomb was still another 20 to 25 seconds away. I couldn't quite understand, looking at the overlay, what they were doing. I'm not sure if they knew.
Yeah, it was a tough draw there, but enemy managed to close it out in what will be unknowingly spectacular fashion. And we move forward to Inferno now, with enemy taking a 1-0 lead into this best of two.
What are your thoughts, though, Jim, in terms of how that map actually unfolded? Because I think that, in my mind, that map was enemies to win all the way along. I want to give a massive amount of credit and respect to the way in which Winter Fox actually came back in and held their poise. Anger in particular went ballistic in that second half, but enemy by all rights should have won that match. They won the first half 11-4, they won the second half pistol, and yet they found themselves in overtime.
Yeah, well, not so much enemies to win, but enemies to lose, because they really led from the front in all aspects of the game. I mean, it was just some T-side indecision, really, and a series of T-side indecisions that led them to fall behind in the second half of that match. And look, they showed that they were strong. They were able to eventually get, and it was only one T-side round that they needed in that overtime,